There's a couple of things you need to know about me right up front. Number one, I am not a technology person. However, I do have a special place in my heart for all of you, because when I break it, you fix it, which is fantastic. So again, I am Tom Epperson. I am the Executive Director of InnerWill. And as David said, InnerWill is part of Luckstone's philanthropy. So we were started as a way to make a positive difference in the world, to take everything that we've learned about leadership and values and culture and really take that out. And so we currently work with clients on helping them with working on their culture, with executive coaching, with really doing training and workshops and a lot of hands-on practical stuff around helping them build leadership capacity. And so I'm here today to talk a little bit about leading through complexity. So as Cammie and I were talking about you, I asked, okay, so what does this group really want to know? What are they struggling with? And the number one thing on Cammie's list is that everybody's in this space where the technology is changing fast, the market is changing fast, the folks that we employ are changing fast, and they look different, and they want different things. And so how do we manage all of that complexity and yet innovate while building incredibly efficient businesses? And so what we're going to talk about today is how we can do that, how we can find that just right place between innovation and efficiency. And so we'll talk about different ways you can do that. All right, so the first thing I'd like you to do is I want you to think about, as you're watching this video, how is this video like your current business? So if you would, turn to the person next to you, introduce yourself if you don't already know, and talk a little bit about how that video is like your current business. Chat, if you would. So give me a couple examples. How is that video like your current business? What do you think?
Complete reversal of direction sometimes.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes we're heading this way, and you got to go that way, right? What else? Nobody died, right, yeah.
That we saw.
Yeah.
That we saw. That was amazing. Yeah.
So in the middle of all that chaos, seemed like everybody was okay. What else? Near misses. Constant near misses.
People are taking advantage of opportunity when they saw it. So they're thinking where the opportunity presented itself quickly.
Yeah, my favorite part was the guy. There's all this chaos over here, and this guy just kind of strolls through, you know, one of these. Like, in that bus is bearing down on him, and he's like, you're going to wait for me, right?
Or the one couple, somebody had cars going both sides from like a lady and a little kid, and it missed by inches.
Oh, yeah. And so when I think about that video, there's all this chaos going on, and yet there's still some order. There's some unwritten rules that everybody's following. You know, and so David mentioned Uber. You know, Uber is one of those kind of organizations that walked into a pretty stable environment. You know, the taxi cab industry had been stable since they took over from horses, essentially. And then they blew it up. And now what you're seeing in that industry is it's sort of calming down again. Right? So again, when these complex systems, they get really chaotic over time, they start getting stable and calm, and then something comes along to tear them up. And so that's a little bit about what we're going to talk about today, is how do we thrive in that very real sort of chaotic environment where it seems like there's no rules whatsoever, but there is a little stability if we can create it. So one of the biggest things when we think about today's markets, we think about today's organizations, we think about sort of this global marketplace that we're all in the middle of, is that it's volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. VUCA. So VUCA is one of those terms that the military coined years ago to describe the modern battlefield. And so the military looked for ways of how can we help our soldiers go into these VUCA situations and thrive. Because traditionally, the military was really rigid and hierarchical. You know, you got a general, and they command here, and they command here, and they command here, and that's how it works. And yet in the modern, complex, ambiguous battlefield, that sort of decision-making was less effective. So one of the groups that we've done work with over the years are Navy SEALs. And Navy SEALs are sort of the pinnacle of the military's ability to deal with VUCA. And so when you talk to the SEALs, I mean, they're awfully similar, like a SEAL is a SEAL is a SEAL. And they all have sort of this attitude about getting the mission accomplished. And so the way the SEALs deal with VUCA is, number one, they have this incredibly rigorous BUDS program that weeds out anybody who's not going to be able to cope in this environment. And the second thing is, by the time they've weeded all those folks out, they're really similar. They value the same things, they believe the same things, they focus on the same mission. And then they do all of this training, just train, so it's all muscle memory, so that these guys can react in a heartbeat. And then finally, when they actually go out into the theater, when they actually go out on a mission, before they go launch, essentially they talk it to pieces. So they do a lot of scenario planning. What if this happens? What if that happens? What if this happens? What if that happens? And so by the time they actually hit the go button, they have talked through everything that they're going to face. And then they have to trust, because they're pretty independent operators, they have to trust that those guys are going to make really good decisions in those moments of truth. So contrast that to the Navy, like the larger part of the Navy. So I was speaking to a group, the Navy invited in lots of business folks to come and talk a little bit about learning organizations. Because the current admiral of the Navy wants the Navy to be a high-velocity learning organization. And so they're trying to figure out, how do we get better faster? In other words, out of our 400,000 folks involved in the Navy, how do we prepare them for VUCA? We figured out with the SEALs, how do we figure it out more broadly? And so we were talking as a group, and a young lieutenant sort of spoke up and said, well, when we come through the Navy, when you're young and you've got no rank and you're sort of listening to your superiors, there are three answers that you can give, right? Yes, sir, no, sir, and I don't know, sir. Right. And so that is trained into them from the very moment they start their career, and it happens all the way throughout their career. And so when you've got three answers, yes, sir, no, sir, and I don't know, sir, it's going to make it awfully difficult to deal with VUCA. And so how in our organizations can we prepare our own folks, build the capacity to deal with that? Because if the Navy is struggling with this, imagine all of our modern management practices. We're even less well-equipped to deal with that fast-paced, complex, uncertain, ambiguous environment. So I thought that rather than to jump right into how do we fix VUCA, we figure out who's to blame. So it's that guy. It's all his fault. So this is Frederick Winslow Taylor. You didn't know you were getting a history lesson today, but Frederick Taylor. And if you've ever heard of a thing called scientific management, this was the guy that kicked it off. So it's the late 1800s. The industrial world is starting to get its legs under it. We're starting to figure out how to mass produce things. Technology started going off at a rocket ship pace. We started building more and more marvels, everything from the combustion engine to the telegraph to ultimately things like recording sound. And so Taylor grows up in this environment. He's a mechanical engineer. He's working in the steel industry. And he recognized something. Hardly a competent workman can be found who does not devote considerable amount of time to studying just how slowly he can work and still convince his employer that he's going at a good pace. And so Taylor decides, you know what? I can do something about this. I'm an engineer. I understand process. So what kind of processes can we put in place that can not just help someone who can clearly optimize their work, but optimize our businesses and make them more productive? Because up to this point, you had a lot of craftsmen. You had a lot of folks who were moving from the farm into the cities, a lot of folks who had little education. And so how do you take these folks who weren't really equipped to work in an industrial setting and help them do so? And also help them be more productive and get paid more at the same time? Because at the time, everything was done piecemeal and piecework. So every widget that you made, you got paid for. And so what Taylor decided to do was to take these big complex tasks, break them in into the tiny components, and that there was one right way to do everything. And so literally think about someone who's using a shovel, right? Taylor would analyze all the people using shovels. He would not jot down a bunch of notes. He would pick the one right way to use a shovel, and then he'd teach everybody that one process. And so he took what he called scientific management, brought it to the business world, and said, look what I've done. And he was sort of one of those first management consultants. And what started happening was we took scientific management, and as Henry Ford developed all of his processes and we became an industrialized nation, essentially we took these ideas, there's one right way, take a big job, break it into its component pieces, but more importantly, control everything you can and drive that through a process. So the answer for Taylor was control. And so we controlled and controlled and controlled and controlled. So if you hate Gantt charts, his fault, right? He was the father of scientific management, which led to project management, which ultimately led to TQM, which ultimately led to Six Sigma and Lean, all the way to Agile, right? So this guy was one of the folks who inspired all that. Now, the funny thing started to happen. So when it comes to innovation, the thing that works best in that high control model is there's an owner or a person at the top of the organization. They come up with a great idea. They tell everybody else their great idea and say, go do it. And so that's how innovation used to work. And so we built all kinds of businesses around this idea of there's one really smart person. Everybody else is just a pair of hands. Right. But pretty soon, the world got way more complex and more competitive, and information started to flow around. And this model got slower and slower and slower. The other limitation to this model is it's only as good as how smart that person is, right? And if they're brilliant, it seems to work out, right? Apple was amazing under Steve Jobs. But if that guy isn't amazing, then this thing doesn't work out, and it's not terribly adaptable. By the way, can I not talk about Apple if I'm in a Microsoft building? You ever just step in it and realize, uh-oh. And so this new innovation started to come about, right? One that was a little more suited to complex systems where it's ambiguous and uncertain and there's more competitive forces. So the way it works these days is there's a typical problem that we're all facing that we're trying to get our heads wrapped around, right? And there's a bunch of people in the system all trying to work on it, and they've all got relationships. And so the ideas are competing against one another as it moves around the system. But the problem in this really complex system is sometimes the solution that'll ultimately win out, it's not connected to anybody, or there's no relationship there, or everybody who's talking about it is over here, but they're not rubbing antennas with the folks who really have the answer. So as leaders in this current environment that's super complex, how do we help make this whole system work better? How do we make this system smarter, help the information flow more effectively, and ultimately take what's pretty chaotic and turn it into an effective and efficient product? So that's what we're going to talk about. So again, how can we innovate and be more efficient? So the answer lies in building our individual capacity and our organization's capacity to innovate and to communicate and to problem solve and to be creative and to work together. In other words, if we can make smarter people and smarter organizations, we win all day long. And so how do we do this? So in our world, and this idea really did take root in Luck, and that we've experimented with it, we've worked with it, we've tried it out. And so I want to share just a couple of the lessons with you about how you can apply these lessons to our world of innovation and efficiency. So the first way you build capacity is you've got to do it at the individual level. In other words, you got to make everybody in the organization better, smarter, faster. Right? You've got to develop them. The second way you do it is you've got to develop your organization's overall capacity to deliver on it. So it's not just having a bunch of isolated geniuses. It's about connecting them together. And it's about ultimately, how do we build the leadership capacity of everybody so that we can ultimately achieve our strategy and transform our culture? Right. So a couple of basic building blocks that you're going to need. The first one is there's a focus on values. And so at the individual level, it could be, you might, if you think about your workforce, you might have some people who love change. They love new ideas. They love tackling what seems impossible. They get really curious and fired up about it because they've got this thing deep inside them that makes them love it. They've got a value for it. Yeah. But you take a really, really creative person and you put them in an efficient, process-oriented organization, and what's going to happen?
They're going to die.
Boom, right. They're going to struggle. The flip side is also true. If you've got someone who loves control and efficiency and logic and moving from A to B to C to D, and you throw them into like a really high creative sort of setting, they're also going to struggle. Right? And then from an organizational standpoint, you think about our culture, there are value components there too. Some organizations love efficiency and control, and they kind of weed it throughout everything that they do. And then all of a sudden, they develop a strategy that's supposed to be innovative. How successful are they going to be? So they've got to go back and rewire the DNA of that organization if they want to be more strategic, right? Or more innovative. The flip side is true. If you've got an organization that loves innovation, that loves creativity, that loves coming up with new products, and you're looking to be the next Uber, and then all of a sudden you decide, okay, we've come up with this great idea, but I got to turn it into a product, and I've got to reliably produce it time after time after time, you are going to struggle. Right? So the second part is that leadership is a choice and not a title. So in other words, it's not something that you are. It's not about being the CEO or being the director or being the manager. It's this belief that everybody in our organizations can make choices to lead. Right? So in other words, as you think about how do we find the sweet spot between innovation and efficiency and dealing with VUCA, we've got to equip everybody in the organization to make those choices more often than not. Right? That's the secret of the SEALs. They develop the SEALs so that every one of them is ready to deal with those situations as they arise. And if the chain of command gets broken, they still know what to do. So can we do that in our organizations where people can be innovative and efficient, where they've got the capacity to do both? And always recognizing that if we want to make any kind of change in our organization, if we want to make any kind of change in our teams, if we want to make any kind of change in our families or in our lives, it always, always, always starts with us. It always starts with us looking in the mirror. So going back to the example of values, if you're a really logical, straightforward, efficiency-minded person and you're leading your organization, that's going to shape how that organization thinks and feels. And if you want your organization or your team to be more innovative, you're going to have to be more innovative. And the organization will respond. So there's three main areas where we can apply these basic principles, okay, that I want to talk about sort of in a really practical way. The first area has to do with our strategy. So if we're thinking about how do we find that sweet spot, well, it really depends on what are we doing with our business, what are we doing with our team, right? What are we trying to do? What are we trying to be? The second area to focus on is structure. So how you structure the work, how you process the work can be tailored to finding that sweet spot. And then finally, what are the behaviors that are required to do so? So how do we have to act in a way that's going to give us the best of both? So let's start with strategy. Let's talk about Saturn. Did anybody drive a Saturn in the 90s? Okay, I got 2-3 hands. As I was looking for good pictures of a Saturn, I realized those little cars were such hoopties. They were just so ugly and just so, ugh. But at the time, I get a hand up, a disagreement.
Saturn sky.
Oh, yeah. But that was sort of the end of the Saturn life, right? I'm talking 90s heyday Saturn, when everything was bright. So in the early 80s, you've got this really competitive car market. You've got the Japanese bringing subcompacts into the U.S. And GM says, how do we cope? We got to do something different. We've got to innovate. And so what they decided to do is to start a different kind of company and a different kind of car. That was their tagline at the time. So GM decides to start Saturn. And they try to do it as an experiment. And so they name it after the Saturn rocket program, not the planet, because it's going to take them to the moon. They set up a factory that's separate from all the other GM facilities. They negotiate with the UAW to have a different way of working. They train their folks in more TQM-like principles, more team-based principles, and really focus on creating a different culture. And then they also build not only different kinds of cars within Saturn, but also different production lines, and then different ways to sell. So they were one of the first car companies that comes out to say, no haggle pricing. So now we think it's CarMax, but then it was Saturn. No haggle, right? The sticker tells you how much it costs, right? It was different. What happened? So former auto exec sort of said it best. So Saturn had a unique powertrain. It had a polymer body part that didn't rust, that didn't get dented. It had a different kind of aluminum engine. And it, most importantly, had a no-hassle, no-dickering retail sales experience. They were great experiments, but they weren't really GM. And so what started to happen in the 1990s, Saturn was having this amazing experience. They were selling more cars than anybody else. I think they were the number three car model at the time. You couldn't find a Saturn because they were all sold out, and they won award after award after award. And GM saw this, and they said, that's awesome. Let's pull it back in. And do you really need to use a different kind of auto body? We're making other auto bodies over here. Why don't you start using this one? And those fancy paddles, those are just too expensive. So let's go back to our sort of regular panels that we use on everything else. And that engine that you're building, you know, it doesn't really fit our production model. So let's pull that back in. And hey, it's kind of successful in the UAW. Let's renegotiate that. And you don't need your own factory, right? And so GM took their golden goose and then chopped it up and ate it. So strategically, they had a great idea. Let's do it differently. And then they decided, let's stop doing it differently. Different example, Harley-Davidson in the 70s. So everybody now, as you think about Harley-Davidson, you probably get this image of, how can I say this gently? What did you say?
Hell's Angels.
Hell's Angels, yeah, right? That was certainly the model in the 70s. I think more like 60-year-old guys driving in a pack on their motorcycles, right? Feeling the wind go through what's left of their hair. I'm sorry, I was looking at Joe in the back, so thank you, Joe. So Harley at the time in the 70s, they were hemorrhaging money. Their motorcycles were junk. They leaked oil, like brand new, right off the floor, broke down. They had terrible quality issues. Sales were slumping. The brand was slumping. They were in deep trouble. All right. And so what Harley-Davidson decided to do was to totally overhaul not what they were selling, because they still sell motorcycles, right, but how they went about doing it. And so the first principle that they decided to introduce was this idea that a consultant who's worked with us in the past, Tom Kalopoulos, calls the hot stove model, which means you want to listen to what's happening outside of your four walls. You want to pay attention to what your customers say is important. You want to get really, in your world, you want to get really close to the user and understand them. And it's like you want to hold your hand just close enough to the hot part that you can just begin to feel the heat and then respond to that really quickly. As opposed to most of us who say, hey, it's a hot stove, and then we put our hand right on it. Right? And so Harley started doing that. So they started talking to their customers about what they liked and what they didn't like and what they were proud of with Harley and what was distinctive about it. Like even the sound, of Harley is, I think they tried to patent it.
They did.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? And so they used this hot stove model to get really close to their customers and innovate what they were building in their bikes. The second thing they did was this idea called freedom with fences. So in other words, when Harley was trying to turn around in the 70s, they tried control, and we're just going to make you do it right. And they weren't successful. And so rather than going control, they backed off a step. And they said, okay, we're going to establish some really basic values. And those are going to be our fences. And as long as all the ponies stay inside the fences, they're okay. But the minute they get outside the fences, that's when we'll take over and take control. And so what they did was they focused on, rather than trying to over-control everything, let's introduce some total quality management processes, let's get people in teams, but let's give them some basic heuristics, some decision-making rules about how we want them to act. And let's see how it works. And so one of the problems was on their production lines, you'd see a defect and you wouldn't say anything. Because you get paid the same to fight or to march, so why not march? Keep your mouth shut. So what they started to do was to encourage people to tell the truth. And so their factory workers started calling things out when they saw those errors on the line. Or they started trying to say, hey, if we're going to deliver something, we need to actually deliver it. And we need to work as teams. And we need to talk to one another. And we need to be curious about what are the better ways of doing this. And so they took what was a failing, money-losing, getting-ready-to-go-away company and saved it. And so strategically, there are things you can do to choose a strategy, whether it's in your team or whether it's in your entire organization, that are more likely to get the results that you want around innovation and efficiency, trying to pick that just right place. Second thing you could do is really around structure and how you structure the work. And there's really kind of four ways to think about how we find that sweet spot. The first one is kind of goes back to that idea of everybody has values and a preference. And so you see this in like a lot of ad shops where they put the creatives in one room and they put the producers in another room and they make sure that the creatives are being creative and the producers are producing and then they occasionally let them talk like at lunchtime and stuff. So in your business, you might separate your innovators from your operators. Now, in some ways, it works really well because innovators love to innovate. Let's come up with new ideas. Let's think about all the really cool stuff. And the operators who love efficiency and logic and process, they're really good at executing on these ideas. The problem with this model comes when these operators get all high and mighty and decide they want to have good ideas too. Right? How dare they? And then when the innovators get so unfocused that they're just generating idea, but they're never actually putting it in practice. So this model can work. You just have to know the limitations of it. The second model is rather than separate your innovators and your operators, put them together and really focus on processes that bring both innovative, creative people alongside those logical, operationally process-minded folks. And so it's an innovation process or design process or even your project processes. So Agile does a nice job of this. You get that small, multi-focused team that's talking to the end user. You're iterating in small prototypes rather than trying to do one big thing at one time. The same thing if you've ever done anything around design thinking, where you're talking to customers, you're doing lots of blue sky sessions, you're making prototypes. So it's another way of approaching it. The tough part about this is people don't necessarily know how to do it. Right? They don't sort of naturally say, let's together in a small team and work through our diverse issues and talk to customers. Right? It's not natural for folks. And so you've got to build a lot of skill to make these work really well. Third structure option is encouraging mixing in relationships. So the best example of this is there was a technology company based in Scotland. And they moved their entire operation from Scotland to Boston. Why do you think they did that? Because they wanted their employees drinking with MIT folks and Harvard folks. They wanted them close to the same bars that those folks do. Because the idea is if you can get a bunch of smart people rubbing antennas, exchanging ideas, BSing about stuff, talking about stuff, then all of a sudden that's where innovation comes from. You get two different ideas, you bolt them together like Legos, and all of a sudden something new happens. Like transportation, social media and technology makes an Uber. And so the other thing is about building those relationships, encouraging people to sort of, not from a forced perspective, but from a casual perspective, to bump into each other and talk and start to build informal relationships, which ultimately leads to an exchange of ideas, which leads to innovation, right? But this is awfully messy and there's no control in it, right? So the control freak in me sees that and says, that's a terrible idea. I'd rather go back to this one. So fourth and final structure idea is building a loose, tight model. And this is going back to the Harley-Davidson model of freedom with fences. Harley-Davidson was really tight on their values. Here's what ye shall do. But as long as you stay inside those fences, you're okay. And so organizationally or even in your teams, can you decide what are you going to be absolutely tight and rigid on, and then what else are you going to empower people to do however they want? So a great way to do this is to have a really clear vision and outcome of what you're trying to achieve and painting that outcome for folks. Here's exactly what we're going to do. Here's what it should do for our customers and end users. And here's what I expect. And then you back up and get out of the way. Right. So loose and tight. So if you would, take a moment. Talk to the person next to you. Which of these models are you currently using? And is it working? So chat to the person next to you if you would. What are you currently using, and is it working? All right. So, quick show of hands. Who keeps their creators and their producers, or innovators and their operators separate? Who has that model? All right, so let's see a show of hands. Who integrates them and does it through process work? Through things like Agile. Okay, so show of hands, like not everybody was really confident about that. So, who encourages the informal mixing in relationships? So if you ever come out to Luck, you'll see we have got these coffee bars all over the building. Charles Luck III, who was, you know, he was kind of an older generation, used to run the company, kind of led it in a very different time. When he first saw those coffee bars, he once said, "You know, in my day, we used to get our coffee and go back to our desk to drink it." So let me tell you, there's some cultural risk that you put in place when you let people talk to one another without rigid supervision.
Yep. All
right. And then number four, who has sort of a loose, tight model where some things are really clear and other things are totally empowered? A couple of hands. Right. Yeah. So everybody's using a little bit of mix of some of these. Right. And the idea, just like with your strategy, is be really intentional. Again, leadership's a choice. So can you choose to be intentional about how you set your teams up and how you set your structure up to get the most out of that just right place? The final topic is really around behavior. Right? So how we act every day. And so how do we find, from a behavioral standpoint, the mix, the just right place between being really efficient and productive and reliable and innovative with new ideas, new creativity, new things every day? And so sometimes it feels like it can be really ambidextrous, like you've got to juggle with two hands and run a plate with the other, right? And if you look out in sort of the sciency world, they call these ambidextrous organizations, organizations that can both experiment and innovate and explore new ideas and at the same time shift to exploiting all those great ideas and turning them into sellable products. Right? And so really what you're doing as a leader, as you're leading your teams, you're leading your organization, is you're managing the tensions between two polar opposites. Right? You're trying to make sure that you're getting the best of both. So the idea would be, A, you're aware that there are tensions of these two right versus rights, and that you're trying to decide not just what you're most comfortable with, but also what's best for the situation. So to give you an example, all right, if you got a pen, grab your pen, or if you don't have a pen, just imagine your pen and put it in whatever your dominant hand is. So I want you to imagine that you're writing your hand, making your signature, right? Feels pretty comfortable. We've all been doing it a long time. Right? Now put it in your other hand and then try and do your signature. Right? And so there's a tension there. You can do it, but it's not comfortable and it's hard. Right? So what I'd like you to think about, again, is turn to the person next to you and talk really briefly. Between these different paradoxes, these different polarities, which ones are you the most comfortable with? So are you more comfortable with innovation or efficiency? Are you more comfortable exploring new ideas or exploiting old ones? Are you more comfortable supporting people or challenging them? Being direct versus empower? Learning or performing? Focusing on short-term results versus long-term results? Focusing on quality versus speed? Like, which one are you naturally more comfortable with? So just turn to the person next to you. Which one are you more comfortable with just as a natural state? Chat about that if you would, just for a second. So by the way, I assume the folks in the overflow room are having just as robust a conversation, and a fight has not yet broken out. All right, okay. Maybe, but day's not over yet. You got time. All right, so just a quick show of hands. Who is more comfortable on innovation? Who's more comfortable on efficiency? All right. Did you feel a little bad, like if you're an efficiency person saying, yeah, I'm an efficiency person. Yeah. So how about support? So you like supporting your team, a lot of empathy and caring? Like two people. Woo! How many folks in here want to challenge their team and just drive them, drive them, drive them? Yeah.
I like the middle.
You like the middle, yeah. All right. And then let's see, quality versus speed. Who wants it to be perfect? Who wants it to be done? By the way, that's a really good interview question. It's like when you're trying to hire somebody, ask them, which would you rather have, perfect and late or imperfect and done? And then, culturally, think about what's best for what you need.
Yeah.
Right? And so again, the idea isn't that there's one right way, but A, organizationally and individually, do we know what our preference is? B, are we aware of what the market and our products and our teams need? Again, like hot plate, can you sense what's needed? And then C, can you make a conscious choice in doing what's needed, even if it's uncomfortable? So to give you an example, in our own organization, in InnerWill, we started this work back about 6 years ago. Over time, the organization's got a lot more structured, a lot more intentional. And sort of in the early days, it was absolutely about innovation and exploration. What are we doing? How are we doing it? What are we learning? But today, my job, I got to make that thing really efficient and start humming so that we can get the most out of that investment into all the exploring that we did. Right. And by the way, I'm sort of a guy, I can swing back and forth. I love ideas, but I want to get stuff done. Right. And so we've talked about three areas that you can apply some of these basic leadership principles. Again, strategy, picking who you want to be and why you want to be it. Thinking about what do your customers need, again, that hot stove idea, and then being really intentional about going after it. And then number two, thinking about your structure. So how do you structure your teams and your organization to best deliver on that strategy? And then number three, knowing that culturally and from a values perspective, we're going to have preferences. And we might need to build our capacity and ability and in skill in doing things that we're really uncomfortable and we're not really well suited for. But just like any other new thing, if we can get through the awkward stage, we can get through the mechanical stage, one day we could write almost as well with our left hand as we do with our right. So, before you go, I always want you to leave with something practical. So if there's one idea that you might apply. Something simple and quick. What might you try? What experiment could you do starting tomorrow around one of these ideas? So chat with the person next to you. Just one idea. Something simple, something experimental. So, you go back to work. You go back to work tomorrow. You're walking up to your front door. You're putting your hand on the knob, or if there's no knob, in front of the fancy laser door thing, right? But you're getting ready to walk through that door, and you pause, and you think about who and what is on the other side of that door. What is one thing you can do to experiment with these ideas? Can I get an example or two? What's one thing you could do? Yeah, even start by talking about it, right? What else? One thing you could do. Yes, sir.
Be curious.
Be curious, absolutely. About what?
Everything.
Yeah. Being curious about yourself and what your preferences are. Being curious about your team and what their preferences are. Being curious about your customers and what they really want and need. What's actually going on out there. All right, one more experiment. What could you do? Hand on the knob. Yes, sir.
So we as a company are digitally transforming, you know, our offerings. So this being my customer right here, we're getting together in the next week or two to talk about some of these new offerings and get his input as a customer to our ideas.
Fantastic. Now, just a word of warning, Donald is like a hot stove, so you don't want to get too close to it. You might burn your hand.
I can feel the heat right here.
I don't know how to take that.
I think you do. All right. So just to leave you with a couple of takeaways. Number one, leadership is a choice. It's not a title. It's something we can choose to do. If you want to make a change in your organization, it's going to require something different, that choice. And again, this is about developing capacity. You want your whole organization to be able to write with their non-dominant hand. So for me, it's I got it being better at being a lefty. Right? And then finally, change always starts with us. Our teams are professional boss watchers. They are watching you. They are listening to you. They are paying attention to what you say and then if it matches what you do. And so if you want them to be different, whether they're an incredibly innovative group but they need to get a heck of a lot more efficient, then you got to be that. If you're really, really efficient and production-minded, but you need some new ideas, then you're going to have to step over here and be that person. Okay? So model what you want. With that said, I just want to thank you guys for bringing me in and talking to you today. If there's any way that we at InnerWill can support you, we do executive coaching, we do organizational development work and culture work. We help teams with their strategies and with their cultures. And ultimately, we're here as a nonprofit to make a positive difference in the world. So thank you, guys.
Thank you.